right, good evening. Welcome to Vision Baptist Church. Please stand with me. Let's sing together.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a shadow in the sky, not a cloud in the skies, but His love quickly drives it away. Not a doubt or a fear, not a sigh or a tear, can abide while we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He says we will go, never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
All right, good evening, everyone. Ladies, if you'd like to have a seat, and gentlemen, if you want to come forward and pray. I have not been informed about who's praying, but I am sure the microphones will reveal it. So, Steve Morgan, you're going to pray. And Sean's going to pray. And Steve, you got the mic first, so you'll pray first, and then Sean will close us in prayer. I love you guys. So excited to be in the house of God with you tonight. Let's see, crank us up.
Ready to be in your house, Lord. We love you and love your word, Lord. Love the opportunity to sing songs of praise to you, for truly you are worthy. Lord, we pray that you'll continue to do a work here, do your work here, Lord, and around the world. We pray for our missionaries and for their families. Pray for all those that are here in training, all those that are hurting and visiting. Lord, we pray that we'll continue to seek your will and follow you. We ask it in Jesus' name.
Lord, I love you and thank you so much just for the opportunity to know everyone here in this church that you brought together for your will. I just ask that you give us the strength that we can put ourselves in, we can remember to lift you up first, and that we come and seek you. And it's tough at times as we go through these weeks, the days, the things that come up in our lives, that we can just be still and just know you and think on you and trust in you as we get taught from your word. I just ask that it would work in our hearts, that you would reveal yourself, Father. And I just want to thank you again and for all that you've done, and we just give you praise and honor, and we love you so much. And I just pray this in Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen.
All right, let's stand together, shake hands with each other, make each other welcome. Once you've shaken hands with three or four people, you can make your way back to your seat. We are privileged tonight to have a young man getting baptized and excited about what God's doing in Luther's life. Who hollered that out up there? You're like your dad, aren't you? Like your stepdad, whatever you call him. All right. So everybody pay attention. Has anybody got a microphone that could help this man out here? Who's got the mic? Go. There's a video. Yeah, I think, Andrew, you want to go on over there. Stephen, whatever your name is.
Pastor Tim.
That was exciting. I'm glad to see a dad who's raising his children to love Jesus and a dad who's taught them about the Lord, and I'm excited about that, and I know you are too, and it's an honor and a privilege that God's given us as a church to watch these young people grow up right here at Vision. I've been blessed to see that happen. I don't need to explain to you, but I always do. Baptism doesn't save anyone. And baptism is simply a symbol of what God has done in our heart. And you probably think he repeats the same things over and over. But you know, if you don't tell people, they just love to forget. That's not a ritual we do. You gain no merit with God. You do it because you are saying publicly what God has done in your life. It's like internal made external. It's what God did inside. And you're telling people about that on the outside. And so what a privilege it is for us to watch somebody be baptized tonight. Well, our first preacher tonight is Stephen McClure. He's going to preach for 5 minutes. We are privileged to have Jim Roberts. Hold your hand up, Brother Jim. Brother Jim is here tonight after being in India for like ever. Yeah, a long time. And so glad to have him here tonight. Be sure to shake hands with him. Go ahead, Stephen.
Well, I want to thank you for letting me up here. I want to thank you for just listening to what I have to say. If you will, turn your Bibles to John chapter 4, verse 13 and 14. That's John chapter 4, verses 13 and 14. While you do that, I want to tell you a story. When I was a kid, one of the great things we got to do growing up, the day before deer season started, we'd all hike up to the family cabin, go up a couple miles, and by the time I got up there, I would realize I forgot to bring water. And so you hike up several miles, you'd be thirsty, and you'd get there, and on the corner of the cabin was a little well. And the first thing I do is I dip this ladle into the well and I drink the water. And it was great. It was cold. It was clean. It was purified. And it was just like the best tasting water you've ever tasted in your entire life. Well, I would spend the rest of the trip up there just drinking from that water. And it was great. Well, I want to talk to you about a story in the Bible that involves a well. And in John chapter 13 and 14, what's going on is the woman in the well, Jesus and her are having a conversation, and he's explained to her at this point that she's a sinner. He's exposed the fact that she's been married multiple times and that she's unrepentant and that needs to change. Jesus is going to say this: whosoever drinketh this water shall thirst again, but whosoever drinketh the water that I shall give them shall never thirst again, but the water that I give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. So the first thing we see here is we have a well over here and a well over here. We've got two distinct wells. The first one, you're always going to be thirsty from. The second one, never. So this first one, whether it's the well of money, the well of Buddha, the well of good works, the well of church membership, they're never going to satisfy. The well of money will never buy your happiness, let alone your salvation. The well of Buddha, the well of your idols, your false gods, your false prophets, those will never get you what you need for everlasting life. They're just a different way, a different path, a different origin to hell. Your well of good works, when you die and you go to heaven, and you say, here's my well, here's the water in it, here's my good works, it's going to be counted as nothing more than filthy rags. Your well of good works, the good works that you've done, will be nothing more than filthy rags. Your well of church membership, if you think that's what's going to save you, if you're unsaved, when you die and you're like, I'm a church member, it's nothing more than having your name on a roster for a religious social club. You're not. It doesn't do anything for you. But over here, the second well, the well that is described as being a well of water springing up into everlasting life, that is the well of Christ. That's the well that always satisfies. That's the well that you sip from it once and you're never thirsty again. That's the well that once you drink from it, all is finished. You do nothing more. You're saved from it. That's the well that Christ provides for us through his death. That's the well that says your faith is all that's necessary. You're not working your way. You're not signing a roster. You're not buying your way in. You can't do those things. But the well of Christ, Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes unto the Father but by him. That's what the Bible declares. I want to just challenge you with something. If you're not saved, make today the day that you decide that you're going to drink from that well. Make today the day that you decide that I'm going to get saved. I'm going to put my faith and trust in Christ Jesus, and today I will change my lifestyle. I'll have a new name that's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And if you are saved, I want to challenge you with something. Will you go to those that you know are unsaved, and will you show them that well? Will you show them a way they can thirst no more, and that they can know when they die, they're going to heaven with the Savior? Thank you.
We're going to be giving an update on the Van Winkles tonight, and as they're getting ready to go to Turkey. Let's pray, and then we'll take up the offering as I share some more. Lord, we love you. Thank you so much for the opportunity to be in your house tonight. Lord, we lift up your name tonight. I pray that we would be encouraged and challenged by your word as we continue to study it. Thank you for what you've already done in our hearts today. I pray that you would be with the Van Winkle family. I pray for them as they get ready to take off in January. I pray that you would continue to provide for them and encourage them and help them in the next few years, especially as they get started. I pray that you'd be with this offering as well. Use it for your honor and glory as we continue to reach others with the gospel. In Christ's name we pray, amen. It wasn't too long ago that Brady Van Winkle and his wife, they were working the children's ministry here. But then as they began to pray about where God would have them to go, Turkey became the place that they were going to go to. And as they were getting ready to take off, my wife and I started helping in the class that they were leaving. But it's exciting to see a young couple here as they've already served the Lord and they're excited about what God continues to have for them. If you know Brady, he's always got something going on, but he's excited about serving the Lord. And I'm excited that we're going to have this family moving to Turkey to live there. So continue to pray for them. Some of their requests right now, they're praying for the last bit of their support to be raised. So they've been on deputation, they've been raising that support, and it's been coming up. So pray for that last bit. Also, the last bit of setup funds. You know, every time you move, it costs, doesn't it? But just imagine moving international. You know, the cost, the setup. It's not just figuring out where you're buying groceries. There's a lot of details. So pray for that last bit of money to come in for their setup fund. I know they've been working, saving for that. But January 29th is the day they're leaving. And if you're like our family, fall is getting here really quick. And then you got Christmas. January 29th is going to be here very soon for this family. So pray for them as they're getting all the loose ends tied up. But also, I love this. They're praying for Turkish friends to be saved. And then they're praying for young people to give their lives to missions. So continue to pray for Brady and Sarah Van Winkle, especially over the next few months as they get ready to go.
Go ahead and stand with me again. We'll continue singing together.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his and he is mine. bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
You can have a seat. If you have your Bibles, please take them with me and turn to Psalms chapter 15. Psalms chapter 15. This is what the psalmist says. He said in verse 1, Who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? He that walketh uprightly and worketh righteousness and speaketh truth in his heart. He that backbiteth not with his tongue, nor doeth evil to his neighbor, nor take up a reproach against his neighbor, and whose eyes a vile person is contemned, but he honoreth them that fear the Lord. He that sweareth unto his own hurt and changeth not. He that putteth not out his money to usury, nor taketh reward against the innocent. He that doeth these things shall never be moved. The psalmist gives us a description of where God is. He asks the question, he says, Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? That's the presence of where God's presence is. Who shall dwell? Notice this, the description of where God is in thy holy hill. There is something that we need to learn about our God, and that is this. Our God is holy. He is holy. John the Revelator, when he sees the throne in Revelation chapter 4, verses 6, he sees the throne and there was a sea of glass like crystal that was before it, and there was these beasts that were around and before it. And verse number 8, it says, and the four beasts had each of them six wings about him, and they were full of eyes within, and they didn't rest day and night. And this is what they said as they went around the throne where God was. They said, holy, holy, holy. In Isaiah chapter 6, when Isaiah sees the Lord, he looks up in the sixth year, Isaiah 6:1, he says, in the sixth year that Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple, it says. In verse number 2, and above it, the seraphims, each one had six wings, and twain he covered his face, and with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried unto another, and they said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. The thing that we have to realize about our God is this. He is a holy God. There is no fault in him. When John speaks to his beloved children in 1 John chapter 1, verses 5. He says, this then is the message that we have heard of him, and I declare it to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness. So we've got to realize who our God is. He is a holy God. He is a God of light. There is no darkness in him. There is no sin in him. He is perfect. He is wonderful. He is sinless. He's incredible. And David asked the question. This is the question. Who's permitted to have fellowship with you? Who is allowed to dwell in your tabernacle? Who's allowed to abide in your holy hill, God? Who is allowed to be there? In Psalms chapter 15, he gives us these lists. And if you were to read through the histories and you get to find out about this chapter, it's a famous chapter. Benjamin Franklin actually called this chapter the gentleman's chapter. And a lot of people look at this as an integrity chapter. But when I look at it, I see requirements. Lord, who's going to abide in your tabernacle? Who could abide with you in your holy hill? Verse number 2, he that walketh uprightly and worketh righteousness and speaketh truth in his heart. He that backbiteth not with his tongue. Wait a second, I'm out. Does it make sense? When we start going through these requirements, I'm like, there's no way There's no way. Within the first few verses, I'm like, I can't keep this. If these are the requirements, then I can't abide. Listen to what one famous preacher said. He said these, on the grounds of law, no mere man can dwell with God. For there is not one upon the earth who answers to the just requirements mentioned according to these verses. There is nobody out there that can say, I kept it. I did it. I can abide with you. The answer then is, who can fulfill this? And the Lord tells us throughout the scripture, there was one man. He was the man of sorrows. He was the man that came 2,000 years ago. And in his perfection, his holiness, he can abide. Only Jesus Christ can abide in God's presence. And this is what I say. Praise God, I am in Christ. Because I am in Christ, I now have access. Because I am in Christ, I now can come boldly before the throne of grace. Because I'm in Christ, I now can cry, Abba, Father. Not because of my own merit. Does that make sense? But because rather the merit that Christ had now identifies me. That's why the Apostle Paul says in Philippians chapter 3, verses 9, he says, not being found in my own righteousness, which is of the law, but the righteousness of faith, or the righteousness of God, which is by faith. You see, how can we come to God? How can we abide in His presence? And I can tell you by this, for the scriptures, I can't keep these laws. I can't keep what He requests from me. But Jesus Christ has. And because I've been baptized into Him, because I've been joined together with Him, because His Spirit now resides and dwells in me, I can abide, I can dwell because of all what He has done. Now that truth, get that, that truth should motivate me now to live a holy life. He is light, and in Him is no darkness. Now I want to walk in the light because that's where my Savior is. And where my Savior is where I want to be. You see, Psalms 15 didn't give me a list of things to do so I might find my way to the Lord. Psalms 15 was given, but rather to show that now that I am in Him, I should start dwelling like Him. Never forget that. Heavenly Father, thank You for this day. Thank You for Your wonderful truth. Lord, help us to remember that nobody, none of us, we can't abide in Your presence without Jesus. Thank You for giving us Jesus.
Amen. Stay with me one last time. We'll sing together.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Then He shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I live
righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne.
You can have a seat as Chris prepares to sing.
My soul in sad exile was out on life's sea, so burdened with sin and distress. I heard a sweet voice saying, make me your choice, and I entered the haven of rest. I've anchored my soul in the haven of rest. I'll sail the wide seas no more. The tempest may sweep o'er the wild stormy deep. In Jesus I'm safe evermore. I yielded myself to his tender embrace, in faith taking hold of the word. My fetters fell off and I anchored my soul. The haven of rest is my Lord. I've anchored my soul in the haven of rest. I'll sail the wide seas no more. The tempest may sweep o'er the wild stormy deep, but in Jesus I'm safe evermore. The song of my soul since the Lord made me whole has been the old story so blessed, of Jesus who'll save whosoever will have a home in the haven of rest. I've anchored my soul in the haven of rest. I'll sail the wide seas no more. The tempest may sweep o'er the wild stormy deep. In Jesus I'm safe evermore.
Take your Bibles and turn with me, if you would, to the book of Isaiah, chapter 12. Isaiah, chapter 12. Two people texted me in the middle of that song, told me how much they liked that song. So praise the Lord for that song. Before I preach, I'd like to just do a little pastoral business right quick. So let me ask you, if you would, to help me with something. God is blessing us and letting people come to our church. So I would just like to give you some things that I think would help. Number one, everybody in here ought to just really pray for the services. You know, you're not a spectator, you're a part. So when people come in, you see lost people, you ought to be praying for them. You ought to pray for the visitors. You ought to be very friendly with our visitors. Be careful. You always have. I'm just going to keep reminding you. We always have, but keep doing that. We've kind of tried to have, since we started the church, like what's a three-minute rule, which is try to find somebody you don't know for the first 3 minutes. Then after that, you can talk to your friends. Then we've had a 10-foot rule. Somebody gets within 10 feet of you, be careful to run to them and shake their hand. Make sure they feel like they have been made welcome. Make sure seats are available. So, you know, kind of stay aware of what's going on. You don't need to be looking to the back. There will be people watching for the back. When somebody comes to your row, don't be like the lady. I used to travel all the time, and I showed up at a church, and I sat down. I always look through the churches. You know, the old lady's got her bag sitting there. Of course, my wife is that old lady nowadays, but she had her, you know, she has her stuff there, and I'd go in. I'd try my best to find the seat where nobody had anything, and I would sit down, and somebody would come in and say, "We're sure glad you're here, but that is my seat." I was, "Excuse me, ma'am, I will get up and move." I preached recently in Madison, Virginia, I believe it was. I was in a conference, and so I went in and I sat down, and a guy who didn't know me, but he knew a guy in the church who knew me, so he got set up. So he came up to me and said, "Man, we're glad you're here, Brother Gardner. You mind moving? That is my seat." So I said, "Man, I am so sorry." And I got up and he started laughing. He said, "Brandon Freeman told me to tell you that." And so he was just picking on me. Be an unofficial greeter. You don't have to have a title. Shake hands. If there's nobody standing out under the portico, go out there and stand in a portico. Go shake. If somebody gets out of the car and they're carrying 12 babies and 22 diaper bags, help them. Rush to them and help them. Be an unofficial greeter. At the end of the service, be ready to pray and talk to people. There might be somebody that would get saved if you just showed a little bit of interest. And the facts are, in our church, for some reason, people are quite intimidated to come forward, but they might talk to you if you showed some interest, and you could talk to them if they're showing some interest. Give out your phone number. You know, don't be like the pastor. Nobody knows his number. The guy that owns a big business, everybody knows his number. I give my number to everybody. And the people out, like, if it's somebody, if you call and it takes 10 seconds for you to say anything, I figure you're a computer. So about 8, I hang up on you. I usually say, "Hello? Hello, this is your last chance. Hello." And then they'll go, "Don't hang up on me. I am Joe from the computer." And I just say, "Your turn." Work at making friends. Work at making friends. Even on a, you know, as our church gets a little bit larger, God continues to grow us, it's pretty easy for people that sit in that section to be segregated from people that sit in this section. Because y'all are all, you're creatures of habit. You know your group. You're like, "I don't know them people. They go to a different church that I go to." So really, they're here. So you can be friendly to them. Make friends. Feel the pressure of lost souls and revival in our church. I'll be honest with you. Most of the time before I preach, Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Thursday night, I feel the same thing. I am so concerned that I would say the right thing the right way and that I wouldn't hinder somebody from getting saved, but they would get saved. And so please, you need to feel that. Be praying. Be praying God would bring them. Make sure nothing is distracting to them. That means don't go to the bathroom. You know, unless you're really, really old or in the nursery, you should be able to make it an hour. I mean, I'm like the second or third oldest person in the room. I can make it. So I'm pretty sure you should be able to make it. And so try to stay, keep things focused so people know we're here to get them saved and see him come to know who Jesus is. See who you can encourage every time you come to church. Even another church member. You know what? They might be going through a really rough week and you don't know about it. They might have had a health issue. Just come into church and say, "Man, I'm here to exhort, challenge, and encourage my brother in Christ." I hope you'll do that. And I'm going to give you one more. And this is the most uncomfortable of all. Park as far away as you can or on the gravel. We have 115 parking spots on the pavement. There were 128 cars this week, this Sunday morning. 128, that's like 13 more than the official number out there. Now, we park a bunch over here, so there might have still been a few openings. A couple of weeks ago, we had 130 cars on a Sunday morning. And so that means if you can, park a little further away, and don't use a visitor's parking spot unless you are a visitor. You know, training center students can't read. And so sometimes they park in those spots, so we don't want to be like that. Say, man. Oh, man, so it's getting hot in here. Take your Bibles and turn with me to Isaiah chapter 12 now. Isaiah chapter 12. I love you, and I'm excited about what God's doing. He is being so much better to us than we ever deserve. He's been better to us than we deserve ever since we got saved. And he's definitely being better to us as he's letting us see our Sunday school grow. There are 198 people in this auditorium this morning, just in this room. And so that's a great blessing from the Lord. And so I just ask you to help me if you can. I want to go with you through this little short 6 verses of Isaiah chapter 12. Isaiah chapter 12. And I want to talk to you about him being our strength and our song. And to be blunt honest, I am going to spend more time in the New Testament from the passage than maybe in the Old Testament, though I could do it without showing you verses, but I want to show you verses. I really hope you'll get a sheet of paper and get you your Bible out and look some things up, because I want to encourage you, but I also want to help you know a little bit about salvation tonight. This might be some of you that need to witness, you might need these verses. Read with me, if you would, Isaiah chapter 12 and verse 1. In that day, And in that day, thou shalt say, O Lord, I will praise thee. Though thou wast angry with me, thine anger is turned away, and thou comfortest me. Father God in heaven, I pray that you would work and move in our midst. Help us as we learn the Bible. Help us as we understand more and more about what you say. And help us to apply it to our lives. And help us, dear God, to see you work in us. And I pray, dear God, that you would help us understand the salvation you gave us. And I pray, God, that you'd help your people to grow. And I'll give you glory and honor for all you do. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, look at your Bible. Chapter 1, I want you to underline, in that day. Go to your Bible and underline, in that day. And then I want you to skip down to verse 4, and I want you to underline, in that day. Now that's important, because in the context of Isaiah, we're talking about in that day. And in that day is the day that Jesus will come and actually set up his kingdom, the day the Jews are waiting for. Isaiah's preaching to him, and he's saying, God is at work among us, and we have been in captivity, we've been mistreated, but there's a day coming when our great God will bring to pass all of his promises, and all you've been reading about in Isaiah up until now, and it'll be in that day. That's when he sets up the 1,000-year reign. You'll just write that down somewhere. That was Revelation chapter 20, if you recall. It's all through the book of Isaiah, as you've seen verse after verse about it. And then it says, when he sets up that kingdom, you'll notice it says, O Lord. You see, you understand? Look at verse 1. It says, in that day thou shalt say, O Lord. It's a country that doesn't say, O Lord. This is a country that really doesn't say, O Lord. Israel has gotten hard against God, and Israel has pulled away from God. But in that day, God's people are going to say, O Lord, we know who you are. We recognize you. We honor you, because Jesus is being set up in his kingdom. And then underline in that same verse, or don't underline it, you have the whole verse underlined. He said, and we will praise you. We will praise you. This is a nation that has stopped praising God. This is a nation that's been looking at other nations. This is a nation that's been looking at other gods. But now, in that day, when Jesus sets up his kingdom, Israel, who at this time doesn't even recognize Jesus, they will praise him. They'll acknowledge that he is Lord. Look at the same verse, if you would, chapter 12. Chapter 12 and verse 1, it says, thou wast angry with me, thine anger is turned. So look at that verse online, or notice, thou wast angry. You know what that was? It was a 7-year tribulation period that you're going to learn a whole lot more about as we go through the Bible. You can't read the Bible without noticing this. When God came down and said, Israel, you haven't been honoring me, you haven't been respecting me, and I have brought about on you punishment. I'm shaking you to your foundation so you'll know who I am and so you'll recognize me, so you'll say, oh Lord, I will praise you. And so I have been angry. God was angry at a nation, and he tried to shake that nation and wake them up. But look at this. He is no longer angry, because in that day, it's past the anger time. It's kingdom time now. He's gotten rid of those people that didn't love him. He's setting up his kingdom. Thine anger is turned away, and you are comforting us. Look at verse 4. You underlined in verse 4, in that day shall you say, praise the Lord, call upon his name, declare his doings among the people, make mention that his name is exalted. Now Israel is being called on to pray to him, being called on to call out to him. They're to tell everybody who he is and what he's doing and how great he is. They're to make mention of his name. Israel doesn't do any of that now. But in that day, Jesus will be exalted. Jesus will return to the earth. Jesus will set up his kingdom. Jesus will win, and you will know that scriptures are true. You can be ready for whatever he has because you know what the scriptures say, and you know what he's going to do. I need you to understand something. It's easy to look at the Bible and say, well, man, God's people totally walked away from him, and it looks like God really blew it. In the Old Testament, he just kind of shoved Israel to the side, and they're out of the picture. They're no good anymore. So now he's working on a new plan because plan A messed up. He's on plan B now. But here's what he's saying in Isaiah. Oh, no, I'm not on plan B. I got plan A still in effect, and Israel's coming back, and I will be king, and I will be exalted. Now, that's what the whole lesson's really about. Isaiah chapter 12 is about Isaiah saying to them, I've been preaching to you for 11 chapters. I've been fussing at you for 11 chapters. In chapter 11, I told you that a root of David, a branch was going to come up. That was Jesus. I told you that. And this day is coming when Jesus will be elevated. Now, I want you to go with me back to chapter 12 and verse 1. And I want you to go through this passage with me. And I want us to go over salvation for a few minutes. Because it is one book. From the book of Genesis all the way to the book of Revelation, it's one book. We all understand that, right? In other words, the whole book was written by one fellow. There's one author to 66 books. If you understand that, say amen. The author is the Holy Spirit. These are the words of God. These guys didn't say what they wanted to say. God spoke to them. God gave them the words. So we have all these words. So when I'm reading the Old Testament, sometimes I see a picture and I'm like, what's going on here? But when I get to the New Testament, all of a sudden this makes sense. There's a good one for you. You can't understand the New Testament without the Old Testament. It is impossible to understand the New Testament without the Old Testament. And in the passage of Scripture, in fact, is in my Sunday school class this morning in Galatians chapter 3, I showed them very clearly, you just don't even get it if you don't know Old Testament. And so I want you to realize he talks about salvation here. Now, if you look at Isaiah chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. The Bible says, in that day thou shalt say, O Lord, I will praise thee. Though thou wast angry with me, thine anger is turned away, thou comfortest me. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid, for the Lord Jehovah is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. Now, when Isaiah wrote that, he is really not talking about us, and he's not talking about eternal life. He's talking about how God rescues Israel. Israel has been thrown into captivity. Israel is scattered all over the globe. Israel is not God's chosen people, are not being treated like God's chosen people. And Isaiah said, but let me explain to you, God still has a plan. And in that day, you'll see it come to fruition. You'll see God pull it off. And then you'll all say, boy, God really did come through. God did rescue us. God did save us. God did build our country again. God really did fulfill all of his words. But at the same time, this verse is like a perfect picture of our salvation. It's like a perfect picture of our salvation. I want you to go with me, if you would, to Romans chapter 2 and verse 5. You do understand when it says here, you were angry with me. I need you to understand something. God is angry with sin. God hates sin. Sin will be judged. It's easy for us to act like, well, it's not that big a deal. We're Baptists, and we've kind of accepted Jesus, and we're on our way to heaven. But other people are doing their own thing, and everybody's got their own opinions. That is totally not biblically true. Look with me, if you would, at Romans chapter 2 and verse 5. He's angry when people refuse to submit to him, to recognize him, to honor him, and they store up his wrath. Jews stored it up, and you could if you're not a believer. And I know this is a Sunday night, and I'm 99% sure almost all of you are saved, but look what it says. But after thy hardness and impenitent heart, you treasure up unto yourself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. If I were reading that verse right now, I'd want to say, do I have a hard heart that doesn't listen to God? Have I rejected God as he spoke to my heart? Now, if you're a born-again person, you have accepted him. But there are lost people all over the world, and you might have family members that are like hard against God, and they won't accept the gospel, and you know, you just feel real bad about it, and you kind of think, well, God would never do it. In Romans chapter 2 and verse 5, he said, no, they are treasuring up to themselves wrath. This ought to scare us to death. My son, my daughter, my brother, my sister, my mother, my daddy, my neighbor, my friend who rejects Jesus isn't rejecting my church, isn't rejecting my doctrine. They're rejecting eternal life. And they are bringing righteous judgment on themselves. And we don't like that. But the Bible's full of it. Next verse I want to give you about this. He was angry. You need to understand he's angry with sin. In Matthew chapter 25 and verse 46, Jesus said, and these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. And I want you to underline in chapter 25 and verse 46, everlasting punishment. Do you understand that if a person doesn't get saved, they will not go to a place called purgatory? They will not go to a place that will clean them up and knock off the rough edges and get them right, and then God will accept them. They will go to a place in the verse of everlasting punishment. That's quite unpopular today. It's quite not accepted today. In this verse, the Jewish people, Isaiah says, hey, he was angry, but he's not angry anymore. And I can say he was angry, but he's not angry anymore with me and you because we're born again. But you need to understand, this is a real deal here. There will be everlasting punishment. Look at Romans chapter 1 and verse 18. The Bible says, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. That's a hard verse. That's a very hard verse. The wrath of God. We want to say he's a loving God. He is a loving God. But if you hold the truth in unrighteousness, if you mock the truth of the God of heaven, if our family members mock the truth of the God of heaven, the wrath of God will be revealed against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. Revelation 19, 5. We're going to get to the happy part in a minute, but you shouldn't get happy till you've gotten sad. You shouldn't realize, you'll never realize how bright the light is till you realize how dark the dark is. In Revelation chapter 19 and verse 15, out of his mouth, this is talking about Jesus, goes a sharp sword that with it he would smite the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. The fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. Can we be honest with ourselves and realize there really is a hell? Can we realize that our own family members may experience this eternal, everlasting punishment, this wrath of God, if they don't come to know Jesus? That's why we're going to pray. That's why we're going to witness. That's why we're going to share the gospel. Because God doesn't want that to happen. But that is what it says. In Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 31, it says, it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. I just want to, you don't understand. I want you to learn the Bible. I want you to know Jesus, but I don't want you to know facts. I don't want you to feel your head up. I want your heart to be bursting with this. Here's the whole thing. There really is a lake of fire. In my Bible reading this morning before church, it's a straight gate and few that find it. It's a straight gate and few that find it. In other words, it's hard and tight and straight and narrow to get into the gate of heaven. You got to get there, and there's only one way you can get there, and that's through Jesus Christ. And we need to understand hell is real. We need to understand our family members will go to hell. We need to understand our neighbors and our friends will go to hell. We tend to back up like, I don't want to offend anybody. Are you crazy? You don't want to offend them when you know good and well that if they don't get saved, they're going to go to hell. They'll already be offended. We need to understand there really is a hill. The second thing you saw in chapter 12 in verse 1 of Isaiah, which I think is a beautiful picture of our salvation, it says, though thou wast angry with me, thine anger is turned away. And his anger is turned away. For anybody and everybody on the whole planet, he's already done everything that needs to be done for everybody, everywhere to get saved, because Jesus suffered for our sins. Look at 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 18. This is the good news. This is the exciting news. This is what we want to go out and tell people. This is why we want to have services. This is why when they come in here and they hear the gospel, we want to be praying for them, because we want them to realize we're not playing a game. We're not going through a religious activity. This is not some ritual. It's heaven or hell. 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 18, the Bible says, for Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. Sin required a sacrifice. Sin required suffering. Sin requires God's judgment. And Jesus suffered for our sins. Can I get an amen right there? I'm going to get to go to heaven today because I deserve to go to hell. I deserve to go to hell. It's only a blessing that I'm not going to hell because Jesus took my payment. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21, he said, he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God. I really need you to underline this in your Bible. I need you to open your Bible to this verse. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21. But you need to understand this. I'm sin. I deserve hell. My sin is so horrible and so wicked that if God throws me into hell, that God in heaven would have every right to do so, because I am a hard-hearted, impenitent guy who, without his mercy, without his grace, would go to hell. But God saved me. And God saved you. And what happened is Jesus took, and God made Jesus sin so he could make me righteousness. I need you to open your Bible, and I want you to circle in the verse, in him. You need in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, to make sure you've circled in him. There's only one way that that ever happens, and that's in Jesus. It is Jesus who died for our sins. It's Jesus that paid our sin debt. And I'm going to tell you something. Popular Christianity today, you're never going to hear this. Popular Christianity today, you're going to hear how to have your best life now. Popular Christianity, they're going to tell you how you can lose weight, how you can quit smoking, how you can get rich, how you can, whatever they're going to tell you. But the Bible's pretty clear. People are going to die and go to hell. And Jesus died so nobody had to. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 24. God loves us, and he made provision for our sin. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. He carried my sins. So when it comes time to sing one of those songs about how we come to him and how he saved us and how he died for us, you need to know the reality of that. You need to see that as real and true in your life. Jesus carried our sins. He died on a cross when he didn't deserve to pay my sin debt. So I deserve hell. God is angry with sin, but Jesus carried the sin debt of everybody so that we can all be saved. And the people sitting in this room, I'm sure that almost every one of you, if not every one of you, know that you'd go to heaven if you died, but people all around the world don't know. And on a Sunday morning when they come in here and they're visiting our church and we're like, we'd like to have you join, we want you to give money, we want you to attend things, we want our numbers to go, oh no, we don't. We want them to go to heaven when they die. We want them to know Jesus as their Savior. We're not looking at filling up a room. We're not looking at getting bigger offerings. We're looking at people that are dying and going to hell and saying, Jesus loves you. That means they got to have a smile when they come in here. That means they got to have a handshake when they come in here. That means they need to drop their guard because there's so much friendliness in the room and there's so much of eagerness on your part to know them that they'll listen to the gospel and be saved. Look at Isaiah chapter 12 and verse 3. And in that day thou shalt say, O Lord, I will praise thee. Though thou wast angry with me, that's with Israel actually, thine anger is turned away. That'll be because Jesus is coming to set up his kingdom and thou comfortest me. I want to talk to you about how he comforts us real quick. I'll just give you three verses. You know all of them, but let's look at them anyway. Number one, Isaiah, Romans chapter 5 and verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Now, you need to go look at this verse. You need to mark it in your Bible. Look at this. Therefore, being justified by faith. I realized that I could never do enough to get saved. I realized that no matter how many times I came to church, no matter how many times I started doing good stuff and stopped doing bad stuff, I knew I'd never make it in my own ability. Robert preached it very well. We could never measure up. Only through Jesus can we measure up. So in Romans chapter 5 and verse 1, the Bible says we are justified by faith and we have peace with God. Now, why would you need peace with God? Because he was angry with sin. Because God in heaven said, you sin and you rebelled and you don't believe in me and you don't accept me. And because you don't, there is a place called hell. There is eternal punishment. The Bible's full of it. We can never forget that. It can't be ho-hum to you. It can't be ho-hum to you. There is a hell. But look at what it says. Through our Lord Jesus Christ. You should underline that. How do I have peace with God? Through Jesus. Not through the church, not through my offerings, not through being a good guy, but through Jesus. Verse 2, we have access by faith. Access by faith into this grace. That's how I get saved. That's how I get forgiveness, by faith through grace, into his grace. Go with me, if you would, to Colossians chapter 2 and verse 13. He's comforting us now. He's saying, Austin, things were pretty rocky between me and you, buddy. You deserved hell, but I died for you, and you trusted me, so let me just comfort you. We're at peace now. There's a peace between me and God. There's a peace between you and God because you now know your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You now know that you're on your way to heaven. You now know that your sins have been forgiven, and we have peace with God. Can I get an amen out of that? I mean, you should be able to go to bed tonight, and when you lay down and go to bed and pull the cover up about you, you should be able to go to sleep and say, if I die before I wake, I know the Lord my soul will take, and he'll take me to heaven because I've been born again. I have peace. I have peace, which is coming up in verse 2, and I'm probably not getting there, but I'm going to try. Look at Colossians 2:13. You being dead in sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. Chapter 2, verse 13. You know where we were? We were separated from God. We were a long ways from God. There was great distance between me and God because God was right and I was wrong, and because I chose to disobey God. But the God of heaven came down to me and died on the cross for me, and the Holy Spirit of God convicted me of my sin. And then he said this, hey, he quickened you. You were dead. He gave you life. And all of a sudden, I woke up and I said, man, I want to know you, Jesus. Boy, we got to pray when they come in. We got to pray, God, deal with people. Let the song that they sing as a special get into their heart. Let the preaching get into their heart. Let the devotions get into their heart. Let everything we're doing touch hearts. Chapter 2, verse 14, he's comforting us, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. So up in heaven, God's like, here's a list of everything you did, Austin. Here's a list, and you ought to go to hell. And then he erases all of it. Then I don't have time for it, but he nails it to his cross, and he says, if anybody comes by asking about the junk you did, you tell them, I wiped it out, nailed it to the cross. They can go look at it. I took care of it. That's how I'm going to go to heaven. That's how I got peace, through Jesus and what he did on the cross of Calvary. He took away everything contrary to us. He took it out of the way, and he nailed it to his cross. In Romans chapter 8 and verse 1, it says, there's no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. I will never, ever hear God say, you're not going to heaven. What comfort. You were angry, but you're not angry anymore. Your anger's turned away, and you comfort. And though he was talking to Israel, he was talking to them about getting into the the kingdom and Jesus setting up his kingdom, it's exactly what happened in my life. I'm just going to tell you something. I think, though, if you didn't ever realize you was a sinner, I think that if you just think that you, as a little kid, you prayed some little prayer and you never really saw I needed Jesus, you need to be real careful with that. It was hard for me for a long time to admit I was a sinner. It was kind of like, nobody was brought up like me. I was a deacon's kid. I never missed church. If anybody ought to get to go to heaven, it ought to be me. But here's what the scriptures say. All have sinned. That includes you, Austin. And Jesus says, through him, all can be saved. And I have 3 minutes, and I'm going to just throw this next thing at you, and I'll leave out the last part of the verse. But go with me to Isaiah chapter 12 and verse 2. When you realize he is your salvation, when you realize he was angry and not angry and comforts you, then you ought to get this. You can know peace. You do not have to be afraid. Chapter 12, verse 2, behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. I will trust and not be afraid. For the Lord Jehovah is my strength and my song. He also has become my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid because I know who God is. I will trust and I will not be afraid. Now, I need you to look up here and listen just a second. Death is going to face all of us. And death's going to come and take some of our children. And death's going to come and take some of our spouses. Death's going to come and take us. Death's going to come and get your parents. And death's a reality. And humans are terrified of death. You don't have to be terrified of death. Because when you know Jesus, you know who holds the keys to death and hell. You know who has power over the grave. You know who died for us. And you know I can trust. I will trust and I will not be afraid. If I had time, I'd go into this with you. But too many of us let fear run our life. We go around all the time afraid of everything. We're afraid of the economy. We're afraid of what's going to happen when the economy crashes. We're afraid of what's going to happen when a country does this or that. We're afraid of all the news. I mean, if you watch the news, it's enough to keep you torn up pretty good. But here's the deal you have. I'll trust, and I will not be afraid. Why would you trust and not be afraid, Austin? Because I know the God of heaven. I know the God in charge of it all. I know the God with all the power over it all. And I know that the God I serve said that perfect love casts out fear. He said that fear had torment. He doesn't want me to fear. He wants me to enjoy peace and to get comfort from him. So tonight, if you're here and you're not saved, you're not sure of that, you ought to get sure. That's the most important thing of all. You know what bothers me? I'm just blunt honest. Departure from script. It scares me to death that I come in here and do the best I can just to teach Bible and that you would take that as an academic thing just bothers me to no end. That you'd say, man, we're learning all about Isaiah. Now we're in Isaiah. Our church, we really study the Bible. Big a whoop. It's not about knowing. The Pharisees knew stuff. It's got to be applied stuff. Can I get an amen? It's got to be real in your heart that you're a sinner, that you deserve to go to hell, that Jesus died for you, that he made a difference in your life. And now you might brag and say, man, we go to church. We've been through Genesis all the way through. We're in Ezra now, glory to God. We've already been through all the minor prophets. We've covered so much Bible. Who cares if it's not real to you? It's got to be real to you. Are you saved? And if you are saved, let me just tell you what I'm afraid of. I'm afraid we'll not be evangelistic. I'm afraid we won't tell our neighbors. I'm afraid we won't be concerned. I'm afraid when I give the invitation, you know what you ought to be thinking? Austin, don't stop that invitation. I got a friend here who could get saved if you'd not cut off the invitation. Instead, you might be thinking, one verse and let's get out of here. You finish preaching, dump it, and let's go. That's not what we're here for. We're here for people to know Jesus. And it's got to be our heart. It's got to be our heart. And then my next thing is, why are you living with fear? Why are you worried about everything? You don't have to worry. You don't have to worry. You don't have to be afraid of what's going on. You know who you trust. Do you know who you trust? Do you know that you'd go to heaven if you died? Have you learned to get your heart and mind in line with what Scripture says? bringing all thoughts into captivity to obey God. That's what he's calling on you to do tonight. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, I thank you for the chance to talk to your people, and I pray, God, that you would deal with our hearts and draw us to you. Help us go out and share what a great God you are and what salvation is. God, I pray that you would convict us of the need to be concerned about the lostness of our family members, the lostness of our friends, the lostness of people around us. I pray, God, you'd deal with our hearts about that. I pray, dear God, that parents would be brokenhearted till their children come to know you. I pray, dear God, that we would honestly come and lay our fears on the altar and trust you to do a work in our lives with all that's going on, and I'll give you praise. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, may the Lord's dealt with you. You're not saved. You're not sure you go to heaven if you died. I want you to have a chance to know you go to heaven. Would you let me pray with you if you say, I'm not sure I'm saved. I really wish somebody would answer my questions and talk to me. Would there be anybody like that tonight? You say, I'm not sure I'm saved. I'm not sure I'd go to heaven. Let us help you. Would there be anybody like that? Would there be any Christians in this room that would say, you know, I have been kind of unconcerned. I have been kind of calloused about the needs of others. I've been only thinking about what the church services are for me. And I need to be praying for lost people and concerned about people. Why don't you get out of your seat and find a place to beg God to work in our lives? Why don't you beg God to save people? Why don't you beg God to work through you? Let's ask God to do a work here. Some of you may be living in fear. You're allowing fear to dominate your life. You're worried about everything going on in your family. You're worried about everything going on physically. You're worried about all these things, and the Holy Spirit of God has made it clear to you that you should not let fear dominate. You know who you have believed. You ought to be trusting him. I'm calling on you tonight to say, I'll trust him. I will not let fear dominate in my life. I will get my mind and my heart wrapped around the greatness of our God, so I will not let fear rule. Anybody else? Anybody else? Father God in heaven, would you do a work tonight? Would you draw us close to you? Would you help us be brokenhearted for our lost friends? God, would you help us be brokenhearted for our families? God, would you help us to put our fears on the altar and to trust you with them? Our anxieties, our worries, our concerns, help us put them on the altar and trust you. And I'll give you praise. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, you can pray in your seat, or you can come forward here and pray with others that are already praying. And then whenever you're finished praying, you can stand and sing. Don't be in a hurry. Let's let God work in our lives.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name, Christ alone. Cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil, Christ alone. Cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Thank you very much. You can have a seat. 44 years ago, I guess, I was a youth director at Dykes Creek Baptist Church, the first church I worked in. I was a great old age of 19. And a young guy named Dale Fincher, who's now in heaven, he's a little bit older than me, but he had a sweet lady wife, Kay, and she wasn't saved. And he felt like God wanted him to preach. And you'd never known anybody. We'd be in the back room praying for her to get saved. Invitation would be given. He'd go to the altar and he'd pray. And it was like forever. She'd been brought up in a very Calvinistic background. She's, I don't know, kind of hard on coming to Jesus. And he was praying and praying. And one day, Kay walked the aisle. And Kay got saved. He shouted so loud, he scared every one of us in the building. And then he became a pastor of a church, of more than one church, and God used him. And he was actually on the way back from youth camp right inside of Atlanta, driving a van load of suitcases because the other guys were driving the kids, and he had a heart attack and died. And they've been sweet friends of ours. Of course, I don't ever see them anymore, but sweet friends of ours for all those years. But I just would say this. I worry about us. Can I be honest? I worry about us. We come to church, and it's like, Austin, you got any more Bible you can teach us? We'll stick that one in the file, too. We're not here to learn Bible. We're here to learn Bible, yes, but we're here to learn Bible that changes our lives. And we ought to have more compassion about lost people than we would have ever had. We can't forget that. They're going to die and go to hell. And we're here to tell people about Jesus. I hope you take it seriously.
Just a few announcements here. There's a table set up out in the foyer for Shay for a baby sprinkle. It's like a shower, I'm told. Showers for first baby, sprinkles, and then on your fifth kid, you get a hurricane. I guess that's how it works. But we'll be out there till Thursday. There's not as many big events coming up. We've had a busy season of that, and so there's less of that here in the fall. But let's take advantage of it to have activities in our life groups. Also, if you met somebody this morning, very likely they didn't, many times they don't fill out a connection card. So the email address or the phone number you got is the only way we have to contact them. So hope you'll be responsible and follow up with them and contact them, invite them out, share the gospel with them. Thursday night, Brother Don Sisk will be with us. It'll be great. Let's keep inviting kids to Awana's and get them involved in that wonderful program. The big three for the week that we're going to be praying for is the Van Winkle family on their way to Turkey, the Kenny family in Chile, and then Albania is the country we're going to study about and pray for. Let's stand together, shake hands, have a great night.